Hi everyone, this is a basic introduction to how blood glucose is controlled by the hormones insulin and glucagon. The most fundamental fact about the control of blood glucose is that it needs to be neither too high nor too low in the blood, and that the hormone that is released when it is too high in order to fix that is insulin, and the hormone that is released when blood glucose levels fall too low is glucagon. How do these hormones change the blood glucose level? Well, both of them are released by the pancreas, different cells, same organ. Insulin is released from the beta cells of the pancreas and goes into the blood, as all hormones do, and it stimulates cells to take up blood glucose by activating glucose transporters that allow glucose to be moved into those cells. So the level of the blood glucose drops as glucose is moved into those cells. Some cells use the glucose, well, all of them use some of it, but some cells in your body can also store some of that glucose themselves. In particular, liver cells and muscle cells can store that glucose as glycogen. Insulin has other roles. For example, it promotes the storage of fat, but we're not focused on that in this video. If your blood glucose becomes too low, glucagon is released from alpha cells of the pancreas, and it goes into the bloodstream again, just like any hormone. However, unlike insulin, it doesn't act at all these different cells of the body. It only acts at the liver, because only the liver has the enzymes that make it capable of releasing glucose into the blood, of converting glucose into a releasable form. So here you can see these little glucose molecules going back into the blood. Okay, so glucose too high, insulin's released and lowers it. Glucose too low, glucagon is released and raises it. Make sure, by the way, that you don't make the typical beginner's mistake of confusing glucagon with glycogen. Glycogen is a polymer of glucose, it's a carbohydrate. Glucagon is a protein, a hormone that controls blood glucose. Okay, so if you look at what happens after a meal, if you eat a meal with carbohydrates, and almost all meals do have carbohydrates in them, then as those carbohydrates are broken down, or if they don't need to be broken down because you took your carbohydrates pre-broken down, such as in the form of a soda, then your blood glucose level is going to go up as those sugar molecules are absorbed into the blood. And once the glucose level is over about 100 milligrams per deciliter, then insulin will be released. So you can see here the response of insulin right after glucose goes up, insulin's following it, right? And then as the glucose level declines, insulin will also decline because it no longer has that stimulus of high blood glucose. Glucagon has the opposite pattern. It had been high in this particular person before that carbohydrate meal because the person hadn't eaten in a few hours, maybe several hours, and so glucagon was needed to maintain blood glucose levels at a level that wasn't too low. But as soon as that glucose gets into the blood, that suppresses glucagon for several hours, actually, after that meal. Okay, so now we can think about what happens when different changes occur, because it's a way of testing ourselves to see if we really understand this. So the first question I'll give you, and what I suggest, is that you pause the video and decide what you think the answer is, and then continue, is if I starved or fasted you, what would happen to the levels of these three hormones? All right, you've got your guess. So the first thing you need to think about is what happens to glucose. And the reason you always start with glucose is because insulin and glucagon don't really pay any attention to each other. Each one is only thinking about what glucose is doing. So if, of course, you're not adding glucose into your body, your glucose level begins to drop in your blood. So the glucose level should go down. That should stimulate the release of glucagon, and the insulin level should be low, or lower even than before you were starving, because there's not any glucose, any excess of glucose to be put away. So C is the correct answer. We would expect glucose to be down, insulin to be down, and glucagon to be higher than it would have been before you were starved. Okay, let's do a second one. What if I injected you with glucagon? What would happen to your glucose level? And what would happen to your own release of insulin and glucagon from your pancreas? So pause the video and decide what your choice is, and then keep watching. Okay, again, the first thing you want to think about is what's going to happen to glucose? Well, we know glucagon's job is to tell the liver to release glucose into the blood. So the first effect of this injection is going to be to raise blood glucose levels. And then we know that high blood glucose levels, assuming I injected you with enough glucagon, if the blood glucose level gets above 100, then we would expect insulin to be stimulated. Meanwhile, your own glucagon release should be suppressed, not because I injected you with glucagon, but because the level of blood glucose is too high. Again, the glucagon in your pancreas doesn't know what the glucagon level is in your blood. It only knows what the glucose level is. Okay, and this will be important for that last question I have for you. So, in this example, you've been injected with glucagon that raises glucose levels, so we know that glucose is going to go up, insulin's going to go up in response, and glucagon should be suppressed by that high blood glucose level, and here is the answer, B. Okay, last one. If your insulin receptors, which are the, as many of you know, proteins that carry out insulin's work by binding to insulin and triggering signal transduction, if those receptors didn't respond properly to insulin because there was something wrong with the signal transduction pathway or the receptor itself, so that you didn't get much glucose transport in response to insulin binding, how would that affect glucose, insulin, and glucagon levels in the blood? So think about that, and you can look at this cartoon as well, and then decide which answer you think is correct. All right, so we know that we should always look first at glucose, all right? If insulin's being released, but it's not being effective, then we would predict that your blood glucose level would be relatively high because insulin isn't able to lower it as it should. Then it's easy, right? Because we can say if the glucose level is high, then we would expect the insulin level to be high. So glucose is going to be higher, insulin's going to be higher, and again, whenever blood glucose is high, we would expect glucagon to be suppressed. This one is often difficult for people because they think that if insulin isn't working, it's going to give up. But that's just not how hormones work. They can't think about things. Insulin responds to blood glucose. So as long as blood glucose is high, we can expect that insulin will be high as well. This, of course, as many of you will have recognized, is essentially a description of type 2 diabetes. And indeed, in type 2 diabetes, at least in the initial stages of type 2 diabetes, insulin levels are often very high. Sometimes the pancreas of type 2 diabetes patients gets tired out and eventually does release less insulin as it becomes desensitized and worn out. But initially, typically, insulin levels are either normal or high in these individuals. Okay, if you have questions about this, let me know.